contact.
Making contact.
This week, we hear from one organization whose mission is to prevent and reduce pollution in California.
This is massive oil drilling with a lot of noise and pollution. Not letting people sleep 24/7. They're operating under very weak permit conditions by the city of LA, and even those weak permit conditions are not enforced.
But first, we go to Northern California.
My old cat, he had to woke up my mom because I guess like my face was all purple and stuff and I couldn't breathe.
Pre-existing asthma makes kids more vulnerable to smoke from wildfires, and those are increasing due to climate change.
I worry about fires a lot. Like, even today, I'm kind of still worried about fire.
We bring you the experience of one little girl in a neighborhood with high asthma rates and other health challenges.
On certain California maps, there's a swath of downtown Vallejo shaped like a trapezoid. It's census tract number 2509, and it posts some of the unhealthiest community conditions in the state. High asthma rates, low birth weights, and poverty-related stressors that contribute to those poor health outcomes, including, many point out, systemic racism. But if you could zoom in close to get behind the data to the people, you'd find this little girl playing in the living room of a ground floor apartment.
My name's Takira Dennettford. I like coloring, drawing, and hanging out with my friends. And when I grew up, I always wanted to be a scientist. The ones that study like cures and stuff.
In recent years, extreme fire seasons have spewed more harmful wildfire smoke into the air Takira breathes. Experts attribute that trend to climate change. And that global phenomenon is taking a very local toll on Takira and other kids like her, whether they know it or not. Takira is snuggling her cat Oreo while we talk. Her medical records show she was diagnosed with asthma at age 5. She's 11 now. Outdoor exertion is one of her triggers, and she says it can be scary.
We only have PE and I run a lot. It makes me feel kind of weak and stuff, and it makes me feel like I can't breathe. And my, it feels like my lungs are like just closing up and stuff.
Takira lives with her mom and two brothers at the Marina Vista Apartments, a low-income housing development of blocky two-story buildings. Residents here make up a big chunk of the population in Census Tract 2509. And according to the California Healthy Places Index, only 1/3 of 1% of census tracts statewide have less healthy conditions. 4 years ago, Takira had her first big crisis.
Well, on that day when the asthma attack, I was really, really sick, and when I fell asleep, I remember my old cat, he had woke up my mom because I guess like my face was all purple and stuff and I couldn't breathe.
Her mom, Shantiera Dalton, ran into the living room where Takira sleeps.
When I looked at her face, I hurry up and put the treatment on her. I immediately rushed her to the hospital, and they gave her helium and oxygen at the same time to open up her lungs to have her to breathe again.
Takira is thin and lithe, like a blade of wild grass swaying in the wind. She tends to put a positive spin on things, even that emergency treatment of Heliox, which doctors save for the most serious cases.
I was put on that for an hour. I couldn't even talk because the thing was on my mouth and on my nose. It made me sound like a squeaky mouse.
Takira stayed in the hospital for days and went home with a bunch of new prescriptions. But her records show her mom would run out of some key maintenance meds over the next few years, partly because of hitches with her Medi-Cal, the government insurance program that serves low-income families in this state. Gaps in Takira's treatment made controlling her asthma harder, and she landed back in the ER again and again. Meanwhile, the most destructive fires in California history started burning.
Sonoma County Sheriff's Office, mandatory evacuation order. Leave your homes.
Come on, she's disabled.
All right, let me get her feet.
That's a deputy's body cam from the 2017 Tubbs Fire, which burned parts of Napa and Sonoma counties, decimating several Santa Rosa neighborhoods. Its speed and ferocity made it the most destructive in California by far, at least for a year. The smoke spread so far that even in the Bay Area, air quality readings were more toxic than Beijing's. But the next year, the even deadlier Camp Fire consumed the entire Butte County town of Paradise, generating even more toxic smoke that drifted for several hundred miles. And last fall, as this NBC report notes, the Kincade Fire, which burned nearly 80,000 acres in Sonoma County.
Okay, as we mentioned earlier, the smoke is impacting the air quality both near the fire and across the entire Bay Area. This right here is a time-lapse video from our San Francisco camera where you can see that smoke rolling in.
Even though some of these fires burned far from Takira's home, they produced tiny particulate matter that can travel great distances and lodge deep in the lungs, causing damage. Studies show that smoky days have correlated with spikes in ER visits for lung and heart problems in real time. And Takira's mom and grandma both told me that she felt that short-term damage, even getting sent home from school on high smoke days because of her breathing struggles. But Takira's worst experiences didn't coincide with the poorest air quality days. They came later.
Based on what we know from outdoor air pollution and about asthma biology in general, the effects can be cumulative.
That's Dr. John Balms, a professor of medicine and environmental health sciences who studies the impact of air pollution on kids. There's a lot we still don't know about the long-term health effects of wildfire smoke, but a recent Stanford University study showed potentially lasting damage to the immune systems of kids who'd been exposed to fire smoke. And an investigation by Reveal for the Center for Investigative Reporting found a spike in ER visits for lung and heart ailments 3 to 5 months after the Tubbs fire. So, like with daily air pollution, Baum says, it's pretty clear the insult of smoke to the lungs can cause harm over time.
A child could be exposed to wildfire smoke for a period and have some increase in airway inflammation, which would then put them at greater risk for exacerbations from allergens that they're sensitized to, or make them more at risk for having exacerbation when they get a cold.
Environmental justice issues come into play, too. Takira is Black, and Black children are disproportionately affected by asthma, more likely to be hospitalized for it and even to die from it, especially in low-income neighborhoods like this census tract, home to Vallejo's most concentrated Black population. Those asthma trends are due in part to greater exposure to air pollution from industry and freeway soot. But, Baum says, also
discrimination, poor housing, poverty, crime, negative aspects of neighborhoods such as noise, garbage.
Baum is researching that stew of factors right now in Richmond, not far from Vallejo. He's focusing on daily air quality conditions, but says that wildfire smoke
is likely to differentially impact kids in these neighborhoods.
In the year following the Tubbs fire, Takira's records show she was rushed to Kaiser Vallejo's emergency room every 3 to 4 months, wheezing and short of breath. Then the Camp Fire started burning, and a week later, Vallejo posted its worst air quality of 2018. Shantiera, Takira's mom, says she followed public health advice, like this warning from our report on KPIX.
In a statement, the Air District urged people to stay inside with windows and doors closed until smoke levels subside and warned that the most vulnerable populations are the elderly, those with respiratory illnesses, and children.
Windows and doors closed. That helps if your windows and doors keep the smoke out. But Marina Vista's oldest apartment blocks were built about 50 years ago. And about half a dozen residents, including Shantiera, told me the smoke came right in.
It got a lot of aluminum windows. I feel like we need double painted windows or something.
Smoke pollution can quickly build to unhealthy levels indoors. It's one of those areas where resources affect health. Balms points out that his wife has asthma, so in their Berkeley home, they've installed a ventilation system with a high-end filter that can be switched to internal circulation during smoke days. They've also got air cleaners in every room. Shantiera did run out to Best Buy for something in her price range.
I had to get a humidifier and an air cleanser. It was clearing up the air, but I guess it didn't work enough for her.
Then, 3 months after Vallejo experienced its worst air quality of 2018, Takira was back in the hospital, working very hard to breathe, the notes say, unable to hold a long conversation.
I was scared because I had to get an IV. I don't like IVs. They always put it in the same arm. But then this one, you know, I was scared, so she took her time putting the fluid all the way in.
Takira was transferred to the pediatric ICU in Oakland again by ambulance.
The road was bumpy and stuff, and it was fun. And then when we arrived at the hospital, I was kind of all scared again. There was just like a whole bunch of doctors and nurses crowding the whole entire bed and stuff.
Can we recover?
Shanchira is a singer, and Takira says during that time in ICU,
she just like sometimes just sang.
Especially during mom's long overnight stays.
It was like a little couch that lets out to a bed.
I need you now, Lord, to carry me high. Don't let the world break me tonight.
But as brave a little girl as Takira is, her mom says these hospitalizations have been scary and depressing.
I pray you'll come and carry me home.
It was just a horrible experience. I just remember crying a lot because they kept coming in the room doing extra stuff to her. I was like, oh my God.
Living at Marina Vista hasn't helped. Notes in Takira's medical file a few months after that ICU stay list smoke and bad air day as a few of her asthma triggers. Others include traffic pollution from busy streets near the apartment, strong-smelling cleaning products, must and mold.
There's a lot of mildew around here, too.
And
roaches can trigger her asthma. Mice. We stay like across where the trash cans are. I feel like they should move them somewhere else or at least spray more often for roaches and mice. Sometimes we'll see them all outside the apartments and inside bathrooms, and it's just everywhere.
Shanchira went to war inside the apartment, but toxic mist can also be an asthma irritant.
That's why I stopped using the bomb. I just got the bait and the spray. There's a lot of kids around here, too, and it's depressing. And all the other apartments around here that are tax credit or subsidized apartments, they're all built way better.
Last fall, Takira was back at the emergency room again on a cardiac monitor, getting a continuous flow of asthma meds through a nebulizer. A week later, Sonoma County's Kincade Fire started raging. Meanwhile, a second grass fire began burning into Vallejo.
I remember, like, the clouds were a little bit pink and stuff, and it was really just smoke everywhere.
Winds were high, too, so PG&E shut off power, a blackout that for Marina Vista residents lasted for days.
The treatments, none of them rely on power, right? There isn't like a thing you have to plug in to give her.
Yeah.
Oh, it does.
Yeah.
That's right. Without electricity, Takira couldn't use her nebulizer in a crisis that could mean life or death. The family headed to Grandma's house in Contra Costa County and stayed through Halloween.
I was Princess Jasmine. Mm-hmm. I was like coughing and stuff, but I was so busy playing with my cousins and knocking on doors to get candy and stuff that I didn't really care.
About 2 weeks later, you guessed it, back to the ER. Asthma has been a part of Takira's life for years now. Inhaling that tiny harmful particulate matter from fire smoke, that's just one of her many triggers. But over the past few years, it's joined the list of forces outside her control that cause her anxiety.
I worry about fires a lot. Like, even today, I'm kind of still worried about fire.
During those smoky days last fall, her thoughts turned to her uncle, who also has asthma.
I was kind of worried about him, too, because he lived right down the street, and he also didn't have any electricity.
Oh, yeah. And his daughter was premature, too. And she was having difficulty breathing, too. So, yeah.
Takira and her mom both tell me they tend to associate fire with arson, a single human act of destruction. What's newer to them is the broader phenomenon of global climate change. Science shows that heavy human reliance on fossil fuels has been the main contributor to the accumulation of greenhouse gases in our atmosphere. That has contributed to hotter, drier, longer, and more devastating fire seasons in some parts of the world, including the American West. Shantiera says she now feels like she's part of a larger collective experience with families she's never met dozens or hundreds of miles away, and it's painful.
A lot of lives was lost. A lot of people lost homes and stuff too, because I almost lost my only daughter. Not just me, but for everyone that had to go through that, it was horrible.
The talk of big, out-of-control fires consuming miles and miles of trees, it rings a bell for Takira, even if climate change doesn't.
My teacher was telling us about the fires in Australia.
These whole bunch of trees on fire, and then there's these animals, and they live there. And most of the animals had died from them because their houses were, like, burning from the trees and stuff. I think that he said the birds survived because they flied, but...
I sat down with Takira and her mom in early March, right before the COVID shelter in place started.
I didn't go to school today because my mom's kind of worried about the virus going around and stuff. And, you know, like, it's going to make me feel like I can't breathe anymore or... Like, I don't know all the other symptoms it causes, but that's the only one I know.
I drop by one more time in late June to catch up outside the apartment door with my mask on. Shantiera says Takira's been doing pretty well with her asthma the past few months. Maybe because sheltering in place has reduced air pollution. Maybe because she's just getting older.
She does get scared at times. She's like, no, I'm gonna get sick. I can't touch that. She constantly washes her hands. You know, sometimes her hands get dry. She complains about that. But she's like, nope, I'm not gonna get sick. At least I'm not gonna get sick. Well, I'm like, yeah, I know. She doesn't want that experience. I think she's still traumatized by it.
Some good news? The family's apartment block at Marina Vista is about to undergo a major renovation. It'll take about a year, and they'll have to move to a different unit for a bit. But the makeover should help Takira with some of her asthma triggers. In Vallejo, I'm Lee Romney.
You're listening to Making Contact. To find out more about the people and organizations in this program, check out our website at radioproject.org. When we come back, we'll hear about a community in Southern California with the highest concentration of oil refineries in the Western U.S. In the first part of the show, we heard about Takira Danette Bird's struggles with asthma, exacerbated by air pollutants from wildfire smoke and other tiny particles called PM2.5. Now we'll go to Southern California, where one section of Los Angeles County is bombarded with pollutants from oil refineries, a massive trucking thoroughfare, and one of the world's largest ocean ports. Bahram Fazeli is the Research and Policy Director of Communities for a Better Environment.
So the San Pedro Port Complex, the ports of LA and neighboring Long Beach, and the associated goods movement are a source. The port is the largest port complex in the United States. It's responsible for approximately 40% of the waterborne cargo that enters the country and is one of the major sources of pollution in the area. In addition to that, refineries in the Wilmington-Carson area, which has the largest concentration of refineries in the western United States, is a major source of PM2.5. So Wilmington, which is the southernmost part of the city of Los Angeles, sort of a 9 square mile with a population of around 50,000 working class Latinx. It's situated right next to the San Pedro Port Complex, which, as I mentioned, is the biggest port complex in the country and a major source of pollution. It has that Wilmington and the neighboring community of Carson, it has the largest concentration of the refineries in the western United States, so makes it the major source of pollution for volatile organic compounds, PM2.5, and NOx emissions that results in major health impacts. Also, it has the highest concentration of active and idle oil drilling in the city of Los Angeles. And in addition to that, there are other sources of pollution, chemical facilities and other heavy and light industrial facilities that create a wide range of pollutions. These are compounds like, for example, benzene that are cancer-causing and a wide range of other pollutants that are used in oil drilling activities. NOx is oxides of nitrogen, essentially, that they cause health impacts on their own, and they also are precursors in creating particulate matter like PM2.5. PM2.5 is just particulate matters that are less than 2.5 micron, or each micron is a 1/1,000,000th of a meter. So this is PM2.5 is 1/30th the size of a thickness of human hair. So they penetrate deep into the lungs and cause major health problems. Because fossil fuel is inherently pollutant. So we can do a lot of things to reduce level of emissions in the refineries by better engineering practices, best practices, we can reduce emissions in oil drilling operations and reduce emissions in cars. But ultimately, the best way to protect public health, transition away from fossil fuels altogether, because in addition to being a major public health threat, different aspects of refinery operations are a big threat, obviously, to the climate by creating catastrophic climate change. So it's both a local public health threat and also creates global threats for everybody. So those are the stuff that CBE is working on. We do a lot of work around refineries because we organize in the two big refinery communities of Richmond in Northern California and in Wilmington. We work a lot on, we have an active campaign in the city of Los Angeles to try to end urban oil drilling and phase out urban oil drilling in the city. We are also doing similar things around the county and the state. There's a coalition of us that's working with various folks in LA County to work towards realizing that goal of ending oil drilling in LA County, which is identified and highlighted in the LA County Sustainability Plan, which is called Our County. So that is one of the other things we're working. We also have a statewide campaign where we are trying to phase out oil drilling along the communities that live near oil drilling operations. So we have a proposal for statewide decision makers to phase out oil drilling within 2,500 feet of sensitive receptors, which are like schools, homes, and essentially residential population near oil drilling operations. Reasons why these problems are not being addressed. Extraction, refining, production, combustion, or in other words, drilling, refining, and burning of fossil fuel in cars, trucks, and ships are inherently polluting as well. So, we have to move towards sort of phasing out. So, and also while we are phasing them out, there has to be serious attempts at reducing these emissions because they are a serious public health threat. But the reason these things are not being done, there are political reasons. And it's because oil industry has a corrupting influence on the politics and decision making. They pollute the communities and they corrupt our politics because of the way they contribute to various campaigns. So that has to be addressed. And the way we are addressing that at CBE is, building people's power and providing those technical tools so that people can take charge of their communities and put the right people essentially in the decision-making seat. So that's one aspect, which is a significant impact on the public health stuff. So, you know, if you're expanding refineries without proper analysis by AQMD, or if you're not requiring sufficient emission reduction regulation in the refineries or in other sectors, there is a reason, there's a political reason for that. Another aspect of it is that because fossil fuel is inherently polluting and creates significant public health threats and impacts, asthma, cardiovascular diseases, other respiratory diseases, birth defects, cancer, it has to be phased out. So the question is that how are you going to phase it out? And the way you would phase it out is through a just transition process or equitable transition process. And that requires vision by the leadership, people in charge, in the governor's office, in the mayor's office, the regional leadership. It requires vision, political courage, essentially, and it requires heavy investment of dollars in clean, renewable energy and creating good-paying union jobs in the renewable sector. Unfortunately, we are not really seeing any aggressive actions on either those fronts, either the visionary actions or leadership or significant investment of funds to create those just transition blueprints. And that's what's needed to eventually transition away from fossil fuel and create those good paying jobs for the workers and the community. More than about 15 years ago, a group of folks called us from Wilmington, and they said, what is happening in our neighborhood? There is noise, there's pollution, there's people are getting having respiratory problems. 24/7, the operation that was happening, that was Warren E&P oil drilling operation was happening. So that's when we got first involved with oil drilling, and we went and we saw, oh wow, this is crazy. This is massive oil drilling with a lot of noise and pollution, not letting people sleep 24/7. They were operating under very weak permit conditions by the city of LA, and they were violating those very weak permit conditions, which is actually a trend you see in the environmental justice communities. You see weak permit conditions, and even those weak permit conditions are not enforced. So, we went through the process to the zoning administrator, and this was happening across the city. So this scenario was repeating across the city. So we realized that this is a systemic problem throughout the city. So we need a citywide ordinance. So we proposed a 2,500 feet setback. And within the last year, we worked with the different members of the city council. And for a number of different reasons, we realized that the best way to actually address this issue is not to create a 2,500 setback, but to phase out oil drilling in the city of LA entirely. And that is something that has been, the city attorney reviewed that approach, and they have given a green light. And, they did an analysis and they said it is actually legally defensible. That's the direction that the city is moving on, is phasing out oil drilling.
Bahram Fazeli is the Research and Policy Director of Communities for a Better Environment. The Making Contact team is Sonia Green, Anita Johnson, Salima Hamourani, Sabine Blazin, and I'm Monica Lopez. Thanks for listening to Making Contact.
If you've ever been to a protest in the San Francisco Bay Area, there's a good chance you've seen a group of musicians, like a marching band. And in that group, you may have seen a tall man in a dress, often wearing a wedding dress or a tie-dye dress. That's Dress. Dress Wedding. And he just released a memoir, Get a Life, Chronicles of a Conscious Scofflaw, a memoir. He stopped by the studios at KPFA recently to talk about his book and his life as an activist, including getting arrested some 24 times in the name of justice. his pot dealing days, and his experience co-founding a premier cannabis dispensary in Oakland, Harborside.
I started wearing dresses sort of on a lark. I happened to put a skirt on one day, and walking up Telegraph, I got various positive reactions very quietly. And I thought to myself, this is sparking something interesting. I had done drag on occasion over the years, but this sparked something rather different in how people responded. And I felt it was a way to challenge patriarchy, both in myself and without, and really kind of bring into focus the question of what does it mean to be a man in this society?
So how does wearing a dress challenge patriarchy, and what does that mean for you?
Simply by breaking the rules, the unspoken rule. It's a funny unspoken rule that men are not supposed to wear dresses and that we're supposed to conform to this uniform, some other uniform. And every act of resistance to the unspoken rules, I believe, challenges the patriarchy that governs our society for the deficit and detriment of all participants in the society.
And so wearing a dress is one of your forms of activism. And you have been an activist for some decades now.
40 years now.
40 years. And you've been arrested more than 24 times. And you chronicle this in your book, The Chronicles of a Conscious Scofflaw.
Indeed. That came from a little incident on a much later action in my life where somebody yelled that at me. And I nearly fell down laughing because I felt they would have lost it had they known what my life has encompassed.
So what drew you to activism? How did it all begin?
How did it all begin? So I tell this story in the book. I was an underground pot dealer, and I had earlier and before I really got into that, I had hitchhiked around California fairly freely for a while and felt that people offered a certain amount of trust in that exchange. And as I was accumulating a certain amount of goods and value in my living space, being a pot dealer, I noticed a young couple who was out hitchhiking and looking for a place to stay. And I felt sad that I didn't want to offer them. I felt I could trust them just by looking at them, but I was afraid to take that step to actually offer them any hospitality because of the supposed risk to the value in my space. And that really hit home, and I brought it up in discussion with some other friends in my Grateful Dead drug dealing circle, and it turned out a couple of them were involved in an affinity group that was part of the Livermore Action Group and preparing to do the next action. That was in 1982 at Livermore. And so I and my girlfriend at the time joined that affinity group, and that led to my taking a nonviolence preparation and learning all about nuclear power and nuclear weapons and their intertwined relationship, and the sense that I could actually start to do something to change the world for the better. And that's what really drew me into activism and putting my body on the line and pushing, using my white male privilege to actually try and balance the equation.
Can you talk a little more about what you guys were protesting at the Livermore Labs?
So the University of California runs the labs, and there's a variety of things. There's the labs at Livermore that develop nuclear weapons technology. There's testing facilities in New Mexico, I believe it is. Many of us, being based in Berkeley, we could focus on both UC. My first arrest was actually at University Hall protesting the university's involvement with Livermore Labs. At Livermore Labs, we were trying to block the entire facility for people getting into work to stop that process and to lodge our complaint about nuclear weapons and nuclear weapons development, and the fact that as weapons of mass destruction, this engagement of the U.S. infrastructure, government, all of it, was actually against international law.
So you were arrested five times in 1983, then another five times in 1984.
And again in 85 and 86 and 87.
And you went beyond just your involvement in fighting nuclear proliferation.
Oh, yeah. It was a pretty easy step from there to joining actions against militarism in general, capitalism, imperialism, various other forms of oppression. So eventually the ecology movement, yeah.
Can you talk a little more about some of the movements that you were a part of after Livermore Labs?
Well, so associated with Livermore Labs was also the Vandenberg Air Force Base, now Space Force Base, where missiles are test launched.
That's in Colorado.
No, that's in Southern California, down by San Luis Obispo, Lompoc. Also, I went to Rocky Flats, and that was in Colorado. I went to Pantex, which is where, so Rocky Flats is where the plutonium triggers for nuclear weapons are assembled and disassembled. That plant was shut down some 20 years ago now. And has strangely been turned into a wildlife refuge despite the amount of plutonium that was lost there, untracked. I also went to Pantex, which is where the nuclear weapons are fully assembled and disassembled when they're decommissioned. That's in near Amarillo, Texas. Other actions, so in 1984, the Democratic Convention happened in San Francisco, so there were a number of actions. There was a group called No Business as Usual. We did war chest tours highlighting various corporations in the financial district that were involved in war preparations. Various issues around homelessness, which was an issue still in the 80s, not the as big an issue as it is now, but still a significant issue. Poverty in general, the Redwoods. That wasn't until much later in the 90s, I think for part of Redwood Summer, I went up to the Gypsy Camp that referred to an activist who was slain by loggers. Well, not by loggers, but was slain during a action
in which a logger cut down a tree that killed the tree defender.
Right. So that was in the Redwoods up in the Sinquion Forest. So I went to a few actions there, did some other support work here in the Bay Area, got to numerous remembrance actions for Judy Berry, a longtime activist who was essentially slain by the FBI and the Oakland PD by them planting a bomb in her car and then accusing her of being the one carrying the bomb. What is remembered lives. Thank you, Judy.
Though it hasn't been proven who planted the bomb.
That's true. And the authorities have decided not to continue any further investigation either.
Right. And then you also were involved at the Battle of Seattle.
Oh, yes. The Battle of Seattle, the World Trade Organization, the WTO, at the end of 1999, had posed a summit to try and move its agenda forward. The first day of action, there were some 40 or 50,000 people in the streets, mostly organized labor folks, but a lot of other activists and anarchists who took a more strident tone, actually blocking the streets. So it was interesting in that the labor organizing sector had a big march. We did a big march with them. At the end of the march, they were directed to move off to a less volatile sort of zone, and many of them actually chose to move towards the greater action zone in solidarity with the people who were risking arrest, because by and far the labor movement was not looking to risk arrest. They were there for a one-day action. The rest of us were committed to more days. The various police forces used tear gas, nerve gas, concussion grenades to stop the action. But in the end, we totally succeeded. Many of those delegates chose to withdraw from that convention, and it actually failed in its purpose.
So you're a classic disruptor. Can you talk about nonviolent civil disobedience?
The anti-nuclear movement adopted a nonviolence program as the main thrust strategy for engaging in activism, based in large part on the work of Martin Luther King, Sojourner Truth, Mahatma Gandhi, women suffragettes that won the vote here and in Europe. Because the way we look at it, the state holds all the cards when it comes to violence and is always willing to use them. And the most effective way to really change people's outlook is to reach them through their hearts. And looking to the human in everyone, no matter what our adversarial relationship over a particular issue, gives us a way to reach those hearts and actually provide shift. And it may not be immediate. It's rarely immediate. So we have to look at the long-term seeding and cultivation.
Why risk arrest for a cause?
Risking arrest for any particular cause, it's basically pushing the defense of necessity. It can be used as a step in the legal process. By getting arrested for some minor charge, then one is entertained in court with the possibility of lodging a plea of not guilty based on working for the greater or the lesser of two evils, essentially. That I'm breaking some minor law in order to stop the execution of the bigger law, basically international law. For instance, at Livermore, we are trying to stop the production and development of nuclear weapons, which is completely against international law, despite the U.S.'s being the primary signatory, yet the first nation to ignore all such rules and regulations. So by trying to put our bodies in opposition to the actual process, we're trying to gain a way to go to court and say, we're trying to stop the U.S. from committing a bigger crime by doing the smaller crime. Also, it just puts pressure on the system. It's a way to get publicity as a dramatic act of sacrifice. And shared adversity creates great bonds between people. So it builds trust within the activist circles, and just the strain on the system helps push the lever for to make it stop. You know, Nixon said it wasn't the protests that made him stop the bombing in Vietnam, but we know that it was, and certainly all the other records indicate that that was really what made it happen, was masses of people in the street, many hundreds and thousands of people submitting to arrest, the civil rights movement, another indicator, the SALT marches, the women's suffragette movement. There's so many examples of people willing to make the sacrifice of their liberty to advance a cause eventually makes the change.
It's interesting because you in particular at the time as a pot dealer, you seemed to in some ways have a bit more to lose than others. For instance, if the police wanted to raid your home because you were an activist, you could have been arrested for even more severe charges than being disorderly in public or disturbing the peace.
Yes. So that's exactly why that came to my mind after my second arrest, and I chose at that point to stop being a pot dealer. I returned what I had to my connect and went on my way free of any such concern. So
then how did you become connected to Harborside? Can you talk about that and co-found and what led to you co-founding a cannabis dispensary?
So after 5 years of getting arrested and being that involved, I chose to start a family. And that was not a situation that getting arrested on it, that was not something that I felt it was a responsible thing to continue risking arrest. I felt no such compunction about returning to the cannabis industry as a means to support raising a family. I felt that was had its risks, but losing a job, you know, as a white male in the Bay Area, I felt relatively immune. I wasn't at any major level. I was only dealing pot. It wasn't something I felt was that risky in terms of being investigated on that level. So over the years, the market, if you will, shifted. So in 1996, of course, the Compassionate Use Act passed, Prop 215, and things started developing in the medical cannabis dispensary world. A few years into that, I started middling. I started supplying various dispensaries. First person that I did that with was one of the founders of the Cannabis Buyers Club of Berkeley, a man by the name of Jim Squatter, dear friend.
Now, Jim Squatter, was he involved in Homes Not Jails?
Yes. He got that name by organizing squats, which, for those of you that don't know, are people without houses taking over abandoned buildings to live in. Squatter had been trying to start a different dispensary with the man who became my partner, Steve D'Angelo. He introduced us, and we all worked together for a short while. Jim got impatient with us trying to do things in a way that would suit a city. He wanted to go ahead and do things and wait for the city to catch up. Steve's vision required a different level of cooperation with the city. And so I was happy to stay with him and really bring that to fruition. And that's what brought us to Harborside.
All right. It seems like there's an element of activism of being on the fringe where people have relied on fringe professions like dealing to finance their activism.
Yeah, I always felt that was, well, when I started going back to dealing, I didn't risk arrest nearly as much, but I took part in different actions that were not so arrestable. Worked with Food Not Bombs. I worked with the Bike Friendly Berkeley Coalition. I did work with the Bike the Bridge Coalition. I served on the Bay Bridge Bike Advisory Committee, PATH. I started doing a lot more volunteer work that was not so risky, and I was also able to donate money to those causes. So, yes, I definitely felt my counterculture economy benefited my activism, and I've seen many others similarly inclined.
So throughout your life of activism and then becoming a parent and taking a step back from the front line, still being involved in many movements, there's also a theme that you touch on in terms of your spirituality.
Witchcraft.
Witchcraft.
Yes, through the reclaiming tradition. Absolutely. I've encountered a few of the architects of reclaiming during organizing meetings for Livermore during my first four arrests in 1983. During the 2 weeks we were incarcerated for the Livermore action in 1983, I participated in my first large ritual, which really shifted things for me, because I had been raised as an agnostic atheist. I didn't really believe in any religious structure. And yet I always felt I had an innate sense that there was some unifying force to believe in for the greater goodness. And reclaiming and witchcraft gave me a framework to exercise that within, and a very democratic process to participate. Rituals are structured so that anyone can participate at a level that they feel comfortable and exercise as much leadership as they feel comfortable with. And certainly my gender-bending tendencies were welcomed within that community.
How do you reconcile, or is there any reconciliation between agnosticism and witchcraft, being a pagan?
Well, so agnosticism is saying I don't believe, but I don't completely disbelieve. My parents' point of view was that since they couldn't prove that there was no God, they couldn't completely discount the possibility. I'm of a very different mindset at this point, that I don't believe in, you know, the almighty of the Christian or Judeo-Christian concepts. I believe there's the possibility of many aspects of spirituality, of a greater spirit. And we have many myths to talk about, the stories and properties from various cultures, any one of which can be true or simply a myth, and fragments of it are true. I'd say I'm more of a believer than my parents are, but still no absolutes.
You also write in your book that you were partly influenced by your parents.
Yes, my parents did have a strong sense of social justice. I hadn't realized it when we moved to Detroit when I was about five. My dad changed jobs. And over the course of the 5 years that we lived there, the neighborhood went from 98% white to 98% African American. And I simply related to new people as they came in, and they were welcome in my home and I was welcome in their homes. I didn't learn until much later that my parents had been involved in the segregation movement, had been going to meetings, to outreach, to prepare the neighbors for integration, which eventually turned to white flight. And so they were pretty progressive for where they were from. They were a little shocked by my going to the levels of activism that I did, but I really attribute their sense of justice and equality with my drive to do the same in a bigger way.
You also talk about Black Lives Matter in your book.
The whole George Floyd thing, Breonna Taylor, happened while I was writing the book, and we had a momentary surge of activism and greater hope for justice. I actually, when I finished writing the book, I looked at the statistics and found that there had been at least 100 more police killings of African Americans in this country since that time. I'm disappointed by that. I'm disappointed by the drop in activism. I was really inspired for that first month or so when people were really taking the streets in a big way, and I felt constrained by my age and the COVID thing that I was not able to be out there and participate on the level that I wanted to. But I'm more disappointed that the overall push has dropped out of public focus. I believe plenty of people are still doing the work on the ground and grassroots in organizing, but large demonstrations that really gain that much attention, the level of backsliding we've done since then in terms of voter rights, voter suppression, women's rights, I just pray that it's the darkest before the dawn.
As we look to the future, what are your hopes?
My hope is that we just did solstice rituals. I did solstice at the beach again, and there was this question of hope and community and strength and how to bring that into making a better world. And I really focused on letting the hearts open in the people who are so full of fear that they continue to assault the rights of others. And that's where I see it really needs to happen, is finding a way to override the fear, to coax people into seeing the humanity in all of us as we express ourselves differently, and to come to the realization that that's actually what freedom is, that this supposed America where freedom is supposed to be the great value, the legislators and people who are so full of spite and hate need to just come to a reckoning with themselves and really have something that opens their heart.
Dress Whiting is the author of Get a Life, Chronicles of a Conscious Scofflaw, a memoir. You can find out more about his book or order a copy of it at his website, dresswhiting.me. That's dresswhiting.me. You can learn more about Harborside Dispensary at shopharborside.com. And you can learn more about Reclaiming at reclaimingcollective.wordpress.com. That's reclaimingcollective.wordpress.com. There you can find a local chapter. In the San Francisco Bay, you can visit bayareareclaiming.org. I'm Christina Onnestad. Thanks for listening.
Tune in Tuesday nights starting at 7 p.m. with La Raza Chronicles, a weekly Latinx affairs magazine program with local and international focus, highlighting the social, political, and cultural events affecting the Latinx community. After that, it's international jazz, Latin jazz, and more on bebop, kubop, and the musical truth with Avacha. At 10 p.m., it's the Reggae Express with Spliff Skankin and Tony Moses. That's Tuesday nights on 94.1 FM KPFA and kpfa.org.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K24 8BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at KPFA.com.